Because we're at a turning point. Arkansas has to decide whether to do a better job at educating our people or serve as a conveniently located source for cheap labor. We have a Governor's Distinguished Scholarship that you get if you have a 32 ACT plus some other stuff. And 5 years ago, only 215 kids in the state get that scholarship. This last year, we had 392 kids get that qualify for that scholarship in this state, which is an amazing number. So much so, of course, the legislature only funds us for 300. We were sort of like the Spartans. We wanted 300, the brightest and the best, to get the scholarship. The good news is that the institutions that actually had people that wanted to come here, even if you're at the 350th or 360th, the institutions all agreed to help scholarship these kids if the state money didn't come because of the great growth in that program. So those are all good things and good news. When you get to higher education, there's some issues, and I wanted to share some of those with you and hopefully talk about some solutions. What we do in higher ed is we track students to sort of see what the graduation rate is. And for the students who went to college in 2002, and we tracked them for 6 years, in this state, we have 37% graduated in 6 years. But this really compares to the national average of 55% and for 53% for all the southern states. So we're fairly far off. And really the scary part is that only Arkansas and one other state have a graduation rate in the 30s. You know who that other state is? Everybody says Mississippi. And the answer is not Mississippi.
West Virginia.
Not West Virginia. Well, this is the scary part. And y'all live close to Louisianians, and we have one Louisiana person here, so I don't know if you want to let him close later. But actually, Louisiana and us are the only two states that have a graduation rate in the 30s. And Louisiana is 1 year ahead of, 1% ahead of us. And the scary part is Louisiana's graduates for this cohort did it when they had a flood that interfered with them going to school. So what do we need to do? There are some big issues. So how we do higher education in Arkansas really has to change. It does matter. The governor's really talked about. Without improvement in higher education, our economic development efforts will face enormous barriers. Now, there's, y'all have heard, you know, the old the Mississippi thing. They have this thing that shows the relationship between per capita income and educated workers, those with a bachelor's degree. Well, Arkansas is 49th in per capita income, and we're 50th in adults with a bachelor's degree. Now, businesses who are looking to come to a place, they look at educated workers. And they want to say, well, we want to come to a work-ready community, one work-ready community that has the resources, especially the human capital, that can help us become successful. The good news is for you all, the governor's workforce cabinet has defined what they think the standard should be, at least for Arkansas communities, to be work-ready. And that number is to have at least 25% of your population to have an associate or higher. And y'all are definitely above that number. So congratulations for that. Of course, we're competing globally, and the more, the merrier. And I'm going to sort of explain why that is. If you have an educated community, it's not only just because the workers are smarter, brighter, better. Other things happen, like things that happen today. I mean, this crowd is much bigger than I see in crowds that aren't with the college town. Lots of people interested in civic involvement. There's more volunteerism. There's more blood donations. There's a less need for social assistance, less poverty, less unemployment, and because the data shows less crime, because smart people are less likely to be convicted of a crime when they commit one. So the whole white collar crime thing, it really doesn't work. Those with higher education are more likely to own a home, and before this recession, it used to be a good thing, have higher family income and personal income, have more expendable income, so they can spend it on fun things. For us Southerners that are affluent, we would spend our money on four wheels and bigger trucks and things like that, and education helps us do those things. And they have most importantly, they have the critical thinking skills that help them to be successful in skilled jobs and careers. But we're going to talk about community and how to build a community and what's important. And y'all actually have all the right ingredients to be a very successful community, and of course y'all are successful. But I want to tell you some things about Arkansas and higher ed. 1/4 of all Arkansans with a bachelor's of higher live in what county in Arkansas? Pulaski County. So 1/4 of all bachelor's degree folks or higher live in Pulaski County. Pulaski County is more ready for the business of the new economy than any other county in Arkansas at 28% of its adult having a degree. The scary part is that Pulaski County is the only county in Arkansas above the national average. So when businesses are becoming to look for places, of course, y'all are fairly close. Y'all are in the 20s for bachelors. But did you know this? That 60% of all Arkansas college graduates just live in 9 counties. That 60% of all associate degrees live in 12 counties. And what about this? Did you know that Arkansas has a lower percentage of population with a college degree today than they did in 2002? Now, for us to make Arkansas open for business and economic development, we'll have to today invest in our human capital. Now, Arne Duncan, he's the Secretary of Education. He came to Little Rock in the fall, and he said this. He said, there are no good jobs for people with high school diploma anymore in the modern world, in the modern economy. High school credentials will not give you access to a job that can adequately provide for a family. And I always go back and look at the data and try to verify some of these things. Think about this. In 1970, and some of us remember 1970 and read about it in history books. But in 1970, 74% of the middle class had a high school diploma or less. And the whole idea that you could make the American dream by with the sweat of your brow was very possible. The world has changed. And it's changed a good bit. In 2007, only 39% of the middle class had a high school diploma or less. The middle class was like 35,000 to 75,000 kids or whatever the numbers are. But what's going to happen now is we do not educate our citizens. We don't get them at least some vocational training beyond high school. We will relegate them to low-income jobs. Okay? Now, here's the scarier part. You thought I had already talked about the scarier part, didn't you? Well, early this summer, Georgetown University basically looked at labor reports for all the states, all the communities, and they made recommendations. And they looked down through the future into year 2018 and made recommendations. And this is what they said for Arkansas. Unless there are systemic changes in Arkansas, the Arkansas workforce will look like this in 2018. It'll rank 9th in the nation in the percentage of jobs for high school dropouts. It'll rank 2nd in the nation in percentage of jobs for high school graduates, 47th in the nation in the percentage of jobs for college graduates, and 51st in the nation for people with graduate degrees. Now, the question is that the economy we want to participate in? Will our state flourish? Because we're at a turning point. Arkansas has to decide whether to do a better job at educating our people or serve as a conveniently located source for cheap labor. Certainly all types of jobs are needed in the economy, but you have to have balance to maintain stability and be prepared for the modern future. This fall, we asked some national experts to come into Arkansas and say, well, what can we do? How do we address this Georgetown study? And they went and visited everybody all across the country. I think they came down in this direction and chatted with the president. And this report is out. You get a chance to read it. It's delightful, fun reading. The report is not without critics, and all change documents truly always have critics. But I do really think that it says some things that need to be done in Arkansas to move us forward as a state. And this is some of the things they recommended. One is more equitable funding of institutions. And not so much on the university side they were concerned about, but in law, in Arkansas, it says that we can't fund a community college less than they were the year before, even if they have less students. We also allow the institutions to decide how they distribute the money. So we do a formula in my office and say this is what the need is, and we give it to the legislature, but the distribution is determined by the presidents. And what happens is all the smaller schools decide we want to have at least what we got last year plus a cost of living or something. And what that's end up doing is we have schools that are very rural, certainly worthy of being funded, but are actually funded at over 100% of need. And I have two big colleges, Pulaski Tech College in Pulaski County and NWAC, way up there where Walmart is, paid at 50%. And they're the two biggest colleges in the two biggest markets. But the way we've decided to fund things interferes in our way of doing things. What I believe is that we should do what we tell the highway department is follow the cars. If there's lots of cars, we build highways. And what we have to do is follow where the students are and really where the markets are for helping them become successful. A second part is performance funding. Instead of rewarding people just for having people show up, we should encourage institutions to graduate folks. So we would actually give what we're proposing, the governor in his package will come out with legislation that will allow us to work with the presidents to decide what a good performance funding formula is. But the key to that formula is going to be a fourth of the budget will be based on performance, and that is graduates. Not rates per se, but how many graduates do you produce? Because, of course, that is what helps build the economy. We should concentrate on maximizing student success, and we have to rethink remediation and how we do it now, and we have some recommendations and legislation that you'll find very insightful when it comes out. We'll share it today. We've also got to maximize the ability for students to be able to transfer from institution to institution. If they're accredited regionally, if they're a state institution, we'll give them the same criteria. We should be able to transfer credits back and forth at the same course. We should be sure that some academic programs are not longer than others. In Arkansas, to get a bachelor's degree, 20% of all bachelor's degrees are more than 120 hours. And 120 hours is what the standard number is. Well, should there be that many that are extra long? And certainly we want it to be the appropriate length, but we need to work that out. What's weird is even on the associate degree level, we have a program that's a certificate. You say a certificate program that's 40 hours, you know, sort of like a nursing LPN program kind of thing. Well, in some places it's 70-something hours for the same position. Even for auto mechanics, I've got a program that's 30 hours in one place, that's 70 hours in another place. And it's the same credential. And we've got to work through those things. We just got to make sure that when we deliver something across the state, that there is some semblance of sanity to it. We need to promote graduation in needed fields. And the good news is in Arkansas, if we educate in Arkansas, guess what? We just got a report that just did this. Dr. Burns will get to see this next Friday. Two-thirds of all people who get a degree in Arkansas with a bachelor's after 5 years are still here in Arkansas. Engineers, scientists, biologists, in all the programs, we're keeping those people, which is an amazing thing. So if we're educated in Arkansans, they're going to come back and be a contributor to our economy. Not so much for the folks that come from out of state, about 1 in 5 after 5 years, but still, those folks are contributing to our economy. And I think that can help us move forward and be successful. The other thought is, in this report, and it said we might want to think about how to redesign my department so that it's more effective in guiding higher education. Give them a little bit more teeth here and there. Perhaps put other state agencies that really deal with adult education under them. Some of these things will come about just because politics is slower than someone writing a paragraph, but we have to work through that. And what really works for Arkansas, for those of us that are on the ground. Well, historical change in higher education has to occur, and some of it has happened already. And it sort of happened in a weird way. Now, about 16% of your state money, your taxes, go toward higher education. And the scary part is in the 1980s, how many of y'all went to school in the 70s? Can you get a raising hand? Okay, I went to school in the 70s. In 1980s, how many of y'all went, okay? Well, in the 70s and 80s, 70 to 75% of your cost to go to college was paid by the state. And when we went, it was like 80 bucks a semester or something, right? It was very reasonable. And you're going to be paying $2,500 if you go to four-year college, okay? Something similar to that. That relationship has changed to the point where at the end of the 1980s, it was 60% of the cost was paid by the state. So now it's 50% for the state and 50% for the parents and the students. students going. So this construction state support, of course, is not just Arkansas, but there is a direct relationship between the cost of tuition and the reduction of state support. And in the last 10 years, tuition has gone up 91%. We have to decide. We've got this great need to grow and enhance our workforce, and we have more people going than we've ever had before, and they're paying a bigger part of that. Pell Grant. Did any of y'all go in the 60s and 70s, 80s on the Pell Grant? Anything in? And the Pell Grant is need-based, and the nice thing about it, in the 70s, it paid for 70% of the cost of attendance, which is room and board, tuition, books, food, party money, everything, all the cost of attendance was all 70% of it could be paid with the Pell Grant. Well, that amount today, if you went to Magnolia, Southern Arkansas, you would pay maybe 30 to 35% of the cost of attendance. So the federal agreement with people to help them become successful has changed. How much do you think people borrow in this state to go to college every year? Like new loans in this state, what do you think the amount is? Okay, $500 million, $500 million every year in new loans for kids to go to college. Okay? Now the scary part is that right now there's only two states that have a default rate in loans greater than 10%, and that's us and Arizona. As a person, I'm 52, at age 47, I finished paying off my student loans. You know, that's just the way it works. And it's helped me. It really paid off. But think about, if we only graduate a third of people that go, then there's a lot of people that are trying to pay off those student loans at a salary that's lower than possible. And that impacts the ability to buy houses, to buy cars, to buy all those extra things, four-wheelers and things that we enjoy. So we've got to really think about financial aid. Now the good news is for y'all, theoretically you have a 2.5 or better, correct? A 19 or better. If you have one or two of those things, you will get an Arkansas Academic Challenge Scholarship for the lottery, and you'll have a scholarship that will help you go to college. This year we were able to actually award through that scholarship 13,000 students to go to college directly out of high school. Counting the kids that are in high school and the adults that were allowed to go back, including the people we awarded just this spring, 35,000 students are going to college on that scholarship this year. Amazing difference. To me, that has changed the conversation I've had with students. And the kids, the young people, have had different conversations too. It's not about are you going to go to college, but where, what you're going to major in, not if you're at all going to go to college. We also changed how you do this. You can apply for college on the web. And in the old days, if you had, we had 21 state scholarships. If you wanted to apply for all of them, you had to do each of them separate. And I had a different person in my office who took the paper. Okay, we put it all computer electronically. It was great. But guess what happened? It got so easy that when you apply this year, it's going to match all your skill sets and talents and economic everything, and the computer is going to figure out what you qualify, and it's going to say, voila, you qualify for X, whatever the number of scholarships are, right? Well, we went from having 25,000 people apply last year because it's too painful to this year, 125,000 apply. It's pretty amazing. The hard part is the lottery funds and the state funds aren't as big as the people that need it that are going to college. And so we're trying to work with legislature to sort of maybe trim off a little bit of your scholarship down to something so we can make everybody have an opportunity, but not so low that it doesn't make a big difference. Not just for the lottery scholarship, but for state scholarships. Do y'all remember we used to have $53 million in a bank in unused scholarships because it was too hard for people to apply? That was 3 years ago. $53 million in a bucket. And it was people who didn't apply for those scholarships. Well, the scary part is, because it's so easy now to get scholarships, by July 1st we'll be at 12 million in that bucket. And we project that unless we sort of decide, well, we really need the scholarship, we're going to be down to zero in that money, and we may have to cut back in November, December. So sort of keep that in mind. In fact, right now, how many of you are military veteran? Okay. We have a scholarship in the state that says if you're a veteran and your kid wants to go to college, and you were disabled or you died in action, or your spouse died in action, your kids or your spouse can go to college with state support. Well, we had a big war recently, and guess what? We're telling people we don't have any more money for them in that scholarship. So we have kids of veterans who qualify for that scholarship that right now can't go. That's the type of pressure that's there. One, because the economy, more people are going, but other is we need to think about, are we going to give service to these students to help them with the American dream, to help them with college? I want to close with a couple things, and y'all have questions if you need to run off, fine. But Thomas Jefferson said about the American dream, and I think that's what it's about. It says, I was a revolutionary so that my children could farm and that their children could do art. And really that's what I personally believe is the American dream is three generations. And my dad was disabled vet from World War II. And because of that, all six of us kids living in a trailer and a dog trot in between in Alabama got to go to college. And three of us ended up as doctors. All of us graduated from college. Those are life-changing things, just like the lottery scholarship is getting that same conversation. I didn't have a conversation about if I was going to college. I always knew it because my dad was disabled, but I had an opportunity. It changes the conversation. My relationship with a textbook, my relationship with my teachers, my relationship with activities outside of class were very different because I saw a destiny that made a difference, and that's what we need to do here. And I want to give you all a challenge for this community. Several communities have decided that they certainly need to educate their workers and keep them here in town. And I certainly believe it's a great thing. For me, I've moved a lot, but I know economically I don't think it really worked for me. You know, I think there's great things about being able to stay in your home place and making a big difference in the community. But one way to do that is to provide lots of local scholarships for that. As you know, the El Dorado did it, and they did it with oil money and great local community support. Arkadelphia is doing it. They're doing it a different way, and they're going to try to give all their kids that opportunity. Phillips County has the Delta River Promise, where they're basically paying the difference. So if you get a $5,000 scholarship and you need another $600, they'll pay that difference. It helps the local kids come go to college local and be successful. Think about those opportunities. One would let employers know that come to the state with their kids and they have a great benefit. And it'll actually change your community very differently because it changes the conversation about what it means to be from your community. And it made a big difference. Tulsa has an initiative. There's one place up in Michigan that has an initiative, and we have three or four schools to do it. So anything you can do to expand your current offerings to give so that you can go to your great university would make a big difference. So we're all about the American dream, and we sort of see these issues. Our economy has changed, and we have to move forward. Now, Davy Crockett came through this country, came through Arkansas a long time ago, back when Arkansas was at the head of the economy. We were the economy of the western frontier for a long time. And this is what he said about Arkansas, and I still see it and believe it from Arkansas. He says, if I was going to live anywhere, I'd live in Arkansas with a netter of a half alligator breed, half horse, half alligator breed that lived nowhere else on the face of this universe earth. And he's really talking about the work ethic and the brawn and the care and the effort that the Arkansans did to build the frontier. And what we have to do is rekindle that and understand that if horse breed is alive today, instead of him saying, go west, young man, and come to Arkansas, he's saying, go to college and become successful. Thank you very much.
We have time for questions, if anyone has something.
I get concerned when I read the remediation rates for incoming freshmen.
Yeah, remediation is a big problem everywhere in the country. We're 75% of the students coming into community colleges are remediated in Arkansas, probably 30% or more at our universities, depending on which universities hire. And we have to take people where they are. You know, it's almost like church. You know, take them how they come. And what we need to do is do processes to help them become successful. And I was remediated when I was in college. And I didn't know what I didn't know until I got there. I had a good work ethic. My dad, you know, trained me well, but I needed to be Shane Broadway, who ran for lieutenant governor, now is my deputy director, he was remediated at Arkansas State. He's probably one of the most brilliant people that I have met here in Arkansas. I mean, maybe I haven't met everybody, okay? But he took remediation at Arkansas State. So I think giving people access to success is important, but we have to make sure it works. And some of the legislation, and I'll go ahead and bring that up, what we discovered in a lot of the literature in higher ed now is that remediation that's been done in the last 20 years isn't working. And what we did was say, well, if you aren't ready for reading, writing, and math, we're going to put you in a developmental course, and you have to take this whole rubric of courses before you get to take college courses. Makes sense, right? But if you look at the data, the national data, all the global trend kind of things, what they discovered is that students who got the intervention of remediation and the students who didn't get the intervention sort of snuck off or went to a college that didn't have that requirement had the same graduation rate. Okay? So to some extent, remediation is holding people back. So what we need to do is, and the recommendations nationally now is to actually have them take the college level course, but have supplemental instruction on the side. Give them take the math, but have a 1 hour lab with those students that are in need, that are close to the cutoff score, get into the game. They get an opportunity to show, you know, and like when I went to Auburn, you just went in there, and then they pulled you out, like in English class. They read my first essay as a little boy. I didn't know y'all was an appropriate word. I don't know. So those kind of changes, and what the governor's going to do, and Dr. Burns, he'll probably suggest that you as a board, allow us to have, let students with a 17 ACT have an opportunity to go to a college level course if there's a supplemental course at the institution. And I think that's going to make a big difference. And the other one is the kids that are not very good in reading, writing, math at all, and with the lottery scholarship, 2.5 isn't super high, okay? And there's a lot of kids coming in now that may be remediated, not only in one subject, but in reading, writing, and math. The graduation rate for people with reading, writing, and math at a community college is less than 10%. Okay? It's less than probably 25% at a university. Those interventions are very difficult. What we want to do with those students that are like statistically like a standard deviation out, you know, pretty far down there, is to encourage them to go into some vocational training that's after high school, but it doesn't necessarily need to be, you know, rocket science or English, but make sure they have a skill set so they can be successful, have a living working wage, and be able to participate in our economy. I mean, we need all those jobs, we need all those workers in our economy, we just got to produce those. 60% of all jobs by 2018, the day we talked about whether Arkansas was ready or not, are going to be in Arkansas. Jobs that require vocational training beyond high school, credential, okay, 60%. And right now we're at 28%, I think they said. So we've got to do some things to come back. But I think the future is great, yes, ma'am.
The number of non-traditional students is continuing to rise. I'm kind of curious how those students figure into future planning.
Non-traditional students, the great thing about Arkansas is we understand non-traditional people. I mean, to me, Arkansas is built on people. I didn't mean it that way. So, if you're from the family news, please just. But it's about, we certainly believe in people that become successful the hard way, okay, and come back and become successful. And what we've done, the great thing about the scholarships that we've done here is when Shane Broadway was the legislator, he brought the Workforce Improvement Grant, which is a scholarship for adults. Not many, you know. Scholarships are sort of like Methodist churches. I used to do surveys for Methodist church on the side. And when you do a survey at a church, they always say, take care of the kids. Okay, now the church may have an average age of 86. Okay? And they're always saying, take care of the kids. And what they really need is another minister to help them with passing and moving forward and all those issues. But they would always say, take care of the kids. And what we did in Arkansas for a long time, we gave scholarships to kids right out of high school every time. And we ignored that workforce. Well, one quarter of all our kids are going to have some college and no degree. And what we did with the lottery scholarship, we have $12 million allocated specifically for adults to come back, which is very exciting. The Workforce Improvement Grant that the Shane Broadway did was all about getting people in the workforce to increase their skills. So to me, we're ahead of the game compared to other states in doing the right thing to help those people have a chance at the American dream now that they sort of tasted, you know, the difficulties of becoming successful without a credential. Okay, well, it's 5 till. I hear y'all have to go to work soon. Yes, sir?
It seems that the cost, increased cost of higher education every year far exceeds the
computers.
Cost of living increase.
Right.
Why is that?
It's a good question. Some of it is the consumer price index doesn't have all the things that are expensive on college campuses. Like we have more computers, we have more techno things. So there is a price index for higher ed stuff. And if you actually look at that inflation index versus the one you're quoting, you'll see that we're actually probably 20% more efficient than we were in the 1980s, taking all costs. The big cost or reason for increase in Arkansas is actually we're just increasing the number of students. We've increased enrollment 40% in the last decade. That's a lot of increase. So we're really getting on to the education page. We just have to begin to make sure we have completion. I think we're getting a lot of people with 1 or 2 years. And, you know, since we have an economy that hasn't fully fleshed out having educated workers, you get somebody that's pretty sharp with, you know, 2 years of college, you pick them off. You know, they work at the bank. Bob probably hires all these people way before they graduate. You know, you pick up a smart person because you're really, the credential is just proof that you're a brilliant person. Right, if you have the capable skill set. So I understand that. But eventually, the economy is going to need to have an educated worker with a credential. The key about having a credential is you're marketable. You know, people always tell me, they go, well, you know, if I'm welding, all I need to do is do cross-ex weld or whatever they do, and I'll be successful. Well, that's great for the first job. But the next employer who doesn't know your mama or whatever, or that person comes out of town, maybe they got bought by a foreign national company or whatever, your next credential is going to need to show that you have you know, certain skill sets other than bringing your argument over to the interview. And that requires a credential. And people have to prepare to take care of their own family by having a credential on the work set. That can be very important. And I'll be glad to take some questions individually from everybody after.